I think as per the published program, I think we have a guest login, then Chambers overview. I think Mr. Vivek Agarwal, President ICC, should make the Chambers overview statement first, and then we will begin. Alok, I think.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Actually, our president will give that welcome address and overview of the chamber.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me immense pleasure in welcoming you all in this budget analysis session on Union Budget 21-22, organized by Indian Chamber of Commerce. On behalf of ICC, I want to express my deepest gratitude to all the distinguished speakers who have kindly joined us to share their valuable views and take on the budget. A special thanks to Mr. Adityans, partner and lead East Dhruva Advisors, LLP, and his team, and Mr. Pallab Gupta, Chairman, ICC Expert Committee on Taxation and Advisor, Taxation, ITC. I am really keen to know how the subject experts decode this year's budget and come out with actual implications. And to set the tone of, for the session to follow, I wish to share the Chamber's view briefly with you. The Union Budget has set the foundation for lifting Indian economy from under $3 trillion to $5 trillion. It focuses on making India Atmanirbhar by investing in infrastructure, manufacturing, and healthcare in a benign interest rate scenario. In fact, if you go a bit deeper, we realize that by announcing a 34.5% increase in capital spending over last year at the rate of 5.54 lakh crore, our honorable finance minister has sent a clear message that this budget aims at demand-driven recovery in output and employment. The government decision to embark on an infrastructure investment drive, keeping fiscal deficit target of 9.5% this year and 6.8% for next year, and maintaining the taxes more or less unchanged during these trying times, is a positive indication which we take note on. The budget focuses heavily on developing healthcare and infrastructure. It is heartwarming for all of us to note that upwards of 64,000 crores will be spent on healthcare over 6 years, with an additional rupee 35,000 crores on COVID vaccine in the fiscal year 21-22. When it comes to infrastructure, we can see around 2.2 lakh crores has been earmarked for roads and railways for financial year 21-22, an outlay of rupee 1.41 lakh crore for Swachh Bharat 2 will be implemented over 5 years. Jal Jeevan Mission for clean water would get a support for both urban and rural areas. By now, I'm sure all of us are getting the big picture. And indeed, this Union Budget lays strong emphasis on ease of doing business by reducing compliance, inducing transparency and trust. At ICC, we welcome measures like the announcement to form an asset reconstruction and management company and the institution to deal with NPA or bad loans. I would also like to mention that the government's commitment to fast-track privatization, disinvestment, and monetization of unused assets is also praiseworthy. We at ICC feel Union Budget 21-22 is an all-inclusive budget and addresses the needs of all the segments of society and economy. Together with all of you, I look forward to an enriching session today with so much to discuss, contemplate, and learn. And as a country, we are on our way to becoming an economic superpower that will compete with the very best in the world. On this positive note, I request the session to commence. Thank you.
Look.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. President. Now I would request our taxation committee chairman, Mr. Pallab Gupta Saab, to address the session. And before that, of course, Mr. Aditya Hans, partner, Dhruva Advisors LLP. He will be giving the welcome address for all the guests.
I think as for the schedule, I think Aditya, if you can give the welcome address.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Vikasji. Well, this year's budget has been, someone once told me, no news is good news. So if you ask me, my response would have been that, how would the government meet up with this budget, huge budget deficit? We all knew that there would be huge budget deficit. And how it would meet up with its budget deficit? It's been kind enough not being, taxing the individuals, the corporates, rather it's been lenient on them. And it's looked into more of other non-tax measures. And to discuss this, we will have a discussion on the tax part, which Mr. Gupta will discuss, followed by a more detailed discussion on the provisions with my colleague Ranjit and Basant. And there will also be an economist's perspective. And there will also be the Dr. Azim, who's the founder of Global Healthcare, one of the most distinguished people I've met in a long time in this fraternity. He will be giving, because COVID and the vaccination, that's at the tip of every individual today. So how good is the government faring on the healthcare sector? What is the vision for future? So we've got a very interesting session. First, a little bit brief about taxation by Mr. Gupta, followed by an economist's perspective, followed by a doctor who's a ex-IS officer, and I will speak about him a lot more, followed by detailed reading of the provision by my colleagues Basant and Ranjit. Over to you, Mr. Gupta.
Yes, Aditya, thanks. I think we should again welcome you to the Indian Chamber for this program. It's been a tremendous year. I think I was just trying to recall the last year's budget and thereafter how things really moved, and then the lockdown from late March for so many months, and then all businesses again got started. I remember discussing with some of my colleagues as to the implications of the financial side of the budget when it happens next year, and that has finally happened already. Mm-hmm. It's been so tough. After 100 years, we are having this sort of a major pandemic, and as the FM said, Mrs. Sitaraman, she did mention that she would like to do a budget which would be really revolutionary and bring about major changes if required, since it is trying to overcome the impact of 100 years. Whatever be the position, the thing is, under all these constraints of the government, when the tax revenue collections did shrink, the fiscal deficit ballooned to 23% in between. So the government is still fighting. The nation is still trying to get up and get over the problem. Vaccination has just commenced. So these are the most challenging times for any nation when it really is trying to come over the water and start swimming and get over the problem forever. And with a very ambitious program of having a $5 trillion economy in the next few years' time, the government is determined to really boost a host of sectors and get going and the nation prospering. What we find is, this is the personal view of mine, that in the last, if you look at the last couple of years or even before that, the government has actually been doing a host of things even outside the budget. it's been happening, and we are even having multiple budgetary positions being taken by the government on a continual basis. Major changes, the labor codes, the farm bills. Before that, major changes in the corporate tax rates, which were cut sharply overnight. So things are happening. A very interesting feature of this year's budget has been the focus on important sectors of the economy, which I don't recall having seen so much of mention in the budget documents. For example, healthcare, it's got a huge amount of impetus, and for very obvious reasons, including vaccination. There's been a lot of mention on air pollution, innovation, R&D, infrastructure investments for railways, for power, for shipping, roads and highways. So it's overall, I think the focus is absolutely bang on, because we need to really get over the pandemic fallouts as quickly as possible. And the government has to take the lead role in bringing about the changes. So be it. I think the capital expenditure focus is also very, very healthy. As you know, if the government can spend more on capital expenditure, it does give a return on that investment. And to that extent, the revenue account improves. This is a standard formula. And it appears that the government is focusing on increasing the spending and spending about 5.54 lakh crores this year. We hope they're able to do it well, and we hope that the nation prospers. The funding part is one major problem for the government. This is happening across the world. Printing of notes, the central bank's positioning is extremely critical. So budget can do only a bit of that. But what has been done is, and I think we really support it, that disinvestment aspects has been captured in the budget. For the next year, 1.75 lakh crores is presumed to be raised from strategic disinvestment. Over the years, our experience in this area has not been good for various reasons. The markets have been down, with difficult times, etc. But we do sincerely hope that the government is able to do this revenue raising very effectively. On the taxation side, this is again historically happening from budget to budget. Every budget we have a host of changes. This year, on the face of it, there are no change in tax rates, which is a very, very major thing. So there's some degree of stability and certainty in the tax rate structure for both corporates as well as individuals and others. But a host of changes on the procedural side especially have been done. And Dhruva advisors, who are headquartered in Mumbai and who have opened their office in Calcutta not too long back, they are going to do a detailed presentation today on the finer aspects, on the detailed elements of the changes. Especially on the direct tax side, the income tax side, the changes are more or less very positive to really assist taxpayers, and there are no change in tax rates. But there are certain changes which are also going to affect some of the industries which have been involved in mergers and acquisitions in the recent past. Our sincere hope is we will be representing on that, but whatever changes the government wants to do should be done prospectively for the future years, not for the year which is just about to expire. Especially since this year has been so difficult and industry is just coming out of the woods. So the changes which are of a negative nature should not be done with retrospective effect from April 20, should be done from next year, 21-22 financial year. The other important aspect is basically the coverage in this year's budget on recapitalization of public sector banks. Another 20,000 crores have been provided. There's been a announcement of LIC's IPO. There's been a focus on strengthening the debt markets. I think in India, historically, our debt markets have not been really of interest to, especially to the retail players. And the size is very small. And it's found a mention in this year's budget that they are wanting to strengthen, especially the bond market, bring about an investor protection charter, consolidate the SEBI laws, et cetera, et cetera. There have been some minor changes also in the board structure. I think 50% independent directors to be provided in companies. For insurance sector, the cutoff limit for investment by the external foreign bodies, I think, is being hiked from 49 to 74%. However, even up to 49% not happened till date very effectively, because earlier it was 26%, then the government raised it to 49%. And in this year's budget, they've announced raising it to 74%. This has not really gone off well. So because of a host of issues in this area, so that has to be corrected. There's been a very, very special mention in the budget talk about the textile sector of our textile park, where one can just get in and just get started with all single window clearances. I think that should be done for all important sectors so that India can really get into the manufacturing bandwagon in a big way. During the pandemic, we had a huge problem with the migrant workers. In this year's budget, it's been announced that for the migrant workers, a scheme will be drawn up whereby they will have one nation, one ration card facility. There would be some social security norms. Minimum wages will be provided to them. And there would be scope for far other aspects of further financial inclusion. The allocation for MSME sector also is being increased. The education sector is being given greater focus. The government has come out with an education policy, which further requires certain standardization of regulations across the country and a single higher education body, which will be set up to coordinate on higher education in a very big way, and also for linkages to be established with foreign universities. So that has been mentioned in the budget, and we do hope that it will also get the necessary support. On the financial side, finally, the government has spelled out a figure of 9.5% GDP as the fiscal deficit for the current year, 2021. The shrinkage, that is, the reduction. And that there would be further market borrowings to fund this increased fiscal deficit. Next year, the fiscal deficit is supposed to come down to 6.8% of GDP, 21-22. And thereafter, it is expected to come down further and it is to be brought in line with the FRBM Act. I think she mentioned 3.some%, but we'll have to see what finally emerges, 23-24 and 24-25. For all this, an amended FRBM Act is being also introduced along with the budget this year. The contingency fund is also being created, which was done last year with a 500 crore base. That has been increased to 30,000 crores, which is fairly significant. And we do hope that we have these funds to give us the necessary support to get over various major contingencies. And India is a large nation, and there are problems at different points of time in different areas which need big deployment of funds for us to overcome those issues. As I said, on the taxation side, on the income tax side, although the rates have not been changed, but there have been a number of very healthy changes like non-return filing for senior citizens, reopening period being cut to 3 years from 6 years, except for major concealment issues. No tax deduction for REITs who are not subject to tax. And other small things, dispute resolution for small taxpayers, etc., which will be captured in the detailed presentation. On the indirect tax side, it was a very surprising thing to note that since we have a GST council, which is so active on meeting and firming up different rates and addressing issues, still the government did make some changes in this year's budget. One very major thing was to overcome a Supreme Court decision for Calcutta Club and others regarding the definition of supply. Because as you know, in the income tax world also, it's very well known principle of mutuality, whereby one person cannot, if he puts money from one pocket to another, it is basically mutual. It's not supposed to be income. However, this is applied in income tax law, and the Supreme Court had extended it to the various aspects of service tax, etc. But now the government has said that this will feature as supply for purposes of application of GST. So this is one important change. The other things are actually operational, like the GST one, where the data is fed in for various transactions done during a month. And then the GST 3B, which follows it, where this is supposed to be deposited with the government after adjustment of the input tax credit. And there the government has given some regulations on reconciliation between the two. The other faceless appeal system for tribunals also has been featuring in this year's budget, but we'll have to wait and see how it takes shape as it goes along. I think I have exceeded my time. I again welcome Dhruva to Kolkata and to Indian Chamber. And we wish them all the best in the city for their operations. Although ICC, I hate to add, but I think I should mention it here. We are today actually a national chamber. And I'm saying not because I am from Indian Chamber of Commerce. I have been in Delhi, in the North Block itself. I was present there on some meeting. This was a couple of years back. And there, we had gone for a presentation. And that's where I was told by some senior officials that first the national chambers are being invited. And our name was mentioned along with other chambers of the country like CII and ASSOCHAM and all. So ICC is actually known as a national chamber. We have offices in other cities, especially in Delhi and Mumbai and all. And we have a huge amount of goodwill with the various government setups across the country. With these few words, I again welcome our friends and associates, Mr. Aditya Hans from Dhruva, to start the budget talk. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Gupta. I believe Mr. Chaudhary, the next session after this is that of the economist, right?
Yes. Oh, sorry. Yes. Yeah. There's a presentation before Dhruva by the economic, see? So I would request Mr. Alok Chattopadhyay to introduce the economic present for the economist's presentation.
Thank you, Gupta sir, for your very valuable insight of the and perspective of the industry on this budget 21-22. Now I would request Mr. Shapan Gupta, Professor of Economics, XLRI, Jamshedpur, to share the economic perspective of this budget 21-22 with us.
Okay, thank you very much. Just a correction, I am Shantanu Gupta from XLRI, and I will like to share the screen. First, I will like to thank the ASSOCHAM, the Indian Chamber of Commerce, the Indian Chamber of Commerce for inviting me to this session. I will let me share the screen first, and then I will begin the talk. Okay. Yeah, I'll just make it full screen. So the talk that I was requested to do by Rajarshi Ghosh, Mr. Rajarshi Ghosh, and came to me, the invite that came to me was on the economic perspective on budget 2021-22. Yeah, so the way I have structured the talk is something like this, that where does the rationale for the budget of this year and the budget of previous years come from? So I will like to say, just remind the people that the budget, the rationale usually can be traced back to the economic survey that gives the perspective of the government with the respect to the economy. Let's go back to the year 2020. This was marked by the COVID crisis, and there was a 23% contraction in the GDP in the first quarter with the recovery. So, the growth rate, as has been talked in the economic survey, has been a V-shaped. First, it fell down, and then now it is going up. And a nationwide lockdown was imposed, bringing economic activity to a halt in most parts of the country. And the nation experienced significant deaths on account of the COVID pandemic. Now, the question is, all was this required? The justification of the government is that, as in the economic survey, is saving lives and livelihoods was, amongst a century crisis, that the temporary lockdown strategy, they say, was motivated by the Nobel Prize winning work by Hansen and Sargent, that policy should focus on minimizing losses in the worst case scenario when uncertainty is high. So did it work? According to the survey, it did work. The curve was flattened by September 2000. On the restrictions, they say that the public, investment program centered around the national infrastructure pipeline is likely to accelerate demand and further push the recovery. One thing that the survey and the government is silent about is the crisis on the migrant workers and the tensions they had to go through. It's completely silent on that aspect of the story. Now, the fact is that does growth lead to debt sustainability? If you're talking of reform, if you're talking of a big push to the economy, the question is, where will the money come from? And the government is optimistic. The government is optimistic, it says that given that there is a large government expenditure, that will be a stimulus to growth. And this larger expenditure can be financed with the higher income and the higher tax revenues that it will get in the future. This is a very, very optimistic scenario. And the government says that, this might be optimistic so long as what Blanchard in his 2019 presidential address puts it is, if the interest rate paid by the government is less than the growth rate, then we need not worry about whether, further future tax earnings can sustain the increased expenditure of today. So that is the way. Now, the fact is that the government is going through heavy, heavy expenditure. Where is it going to come from? A part of the expenditure is going to come from government borrowings. And the concern is that India's, as given in the survey, is that India's sovereign credit ratings, is very, very poor. It is very low international rating. It was a BBB minus and a Baa3, whereas we are the fifth largest economy. And when China was the fifth largest economy, it had an A minus kind of a thing. So the question that economists are showing, are the credit rating agencies biased in their outlook towards India? But many economists are of the view, rather than putting the blame on the credit rating agencies, it will be better to clean up our own official statistics, increase our domestic savings to improve our rating, which the government has actually done, making statistics cleaner, transparency. These are things that the government is emphasizing in all its things. Now, the question is, there's been a lot of criticisms on the present government, not just, even before the budget, that the government is favoring big businesses. And that is what I feel motivated this chapter of the economic survey of inequality and growth, where is there a conflict or a convergence? The fact that the rich or the marginal tax rates on the higher income segments have not been increased can be traced to the logic that such acts will have a disincentive and will reduce the size of the pie. And the survey also says that India is at that stage of development when it must focus on economic growth to lift people out of poverty by expanding the size of the pie. And that is why it is the case that the focus has been less on redistribution, taxing the rich and giving to the poor kind of a strategy. Now, the question is inequality desirable? Inequality, if it is in asset holdings, is not much of a concern. But if there is not so much of inequality in consumption, that is not too much a thing to be bothered about. Now, healthcare, there was a huge thing on healthcare, and it says that healthcare takes a center stage finally. Now, we are saying, wow, there is a 137% increase in expenditure as compared to the earlier year. But remember the fact, the surveys also talked about, remember in the Spanish flu also, that do we have the saliency effect? The saliency effect is that something new came, COVID new came, and there was a huge amount of expenditure that was given, of health expenditure that was directed towards COVID. Now, does that mean that expenditure on other things, on health expenditure, preventive healthcare, have that decreased? That has not. So we really do not know, the 137% that is increased, it may not actually been an increase in health to all the things that were being given, but maybe primarily the increase may be because of the COVID expenditure, COVID prevention expenditure, and the National Health Mission played a center stage. The country also has a deficit of doctors and nurses, and therefore there is the thing of telemedicine that needs to be harnessed, for infrastructure, and it talks of telemedicine to be harnessed by investing in internet connectivity and health infrastructure. Now, process reforms is something that the government has said, we have to do ease of doing business. And the government is of the view that there is over-regulation in the economy. There are too much of rules and regulations. They cannot be interpreted easily. And therefore, there is a lot of discretion at the hands of officials. So, there are some aspects, eases the things for citizens and for businesses is the declaration of no filing of income taxes by senior citizens if they have only interest in pension income, maybe have been motivated by the view. Even announcements that tax frauds will be investigated only if the sum is very high and, is also motivated, the thing that, let us not get into over-regulation and let us look into catching the bigger things. There is also the concern that, banks, as a result of distorted incentives, you have to bail out credit, misallocate resources, damaging the quality of investment, and then asking for a bailout. These have been the case. There have been banks, you have to go for bailout of businesses, banks, for sick public sector units. These cannot be, business as usual. I mean, so it has been marked. So So the final thing that says is bare necessities is there should be concern for bare necessities, water, housing, sanitation, macro environment, and other facilities. So, and access to bare necessities is highest in Punjab, Haryana, Kerala, Gujarat, and lowest in Orissa, Jharkhand, and West Bengal, and Tripura. Let me stop the sharing. The other things that I have not captured, that was discovered in the farm bill is one on disinvestment that, a lot of money can come. The locked in resources of the government that can come from disinvestment that has been, and also the huge push, some push to the farm sector. And there was a lot of disagreements when the farm bill, help to the farm sector was being let out. Thank you so much.
Mr. Chattopadhyay?
Alok, I think let Alok coordinate.
Hello?
He's still mute. We have another session now on the healthcare perspective.
Yes.
Oh, sorry. I think we have some of the speakers. So maybe after that, your presentation will begin.
Yeah, now, Dr. Shabat Azim, founder CEO of Grokal Healthcare, he will be sharing his perspective, particularly in the healthcare sector, in relation to this year's budget 2022.
Mrs. Alok, I would just want to introduce Mrs. Azim first and then move into the 2 to 3 questions which are concerning the healthcare. Can I take the opportunity, Alok?
Oh, sure.
We welcome Dr. Azim. And I'm so sorry, I know you were quite occupied with an important program, but thank you for taking out time for this. I know it's in few words, I cannot introduce you your all your achievements and all what you have achieved over your short span of life till now, but I just want in words what I have written, what I could capture, I'll just share that. Dr. Azim is the founder and managing director of Local Healthcare Systems, a doctor and an ex-IS officer and a social entrepreneur. He served the government in various positions like the secretary to the chief minister, director of IT, director of vigilance, joint secretary personal and training, joint secretary cabinet and confidential, district magistrate, etc. He's an alumnus of the Jain Medical College, AMU Aligarh, and LBS NAA Masuri and IIM Ahmedabad. Recently, in November 20, in the New Economy Forum in New York, Bloomberg showcased his work as a game changer in the November 16th issue of the Bloomberg Business Week as one of four people who are shaking up emerging markets. Dr. Azim has been declared Social Entrepreneur of the Year 2020 by the World Economic Forum, Schwab Foundation for Social Enterprise. His innovation, HelloFix, digital dispensary was awarded the Public Appreciation Award 2020 by UN Innovation, United Nations Innovation at the Health Innovation Exchange. And Dr. Azim has been involved in healthcare for a long time, having been the Indian Rapporteur for Digital Health, e-health at WSISI's Forum 2009 at the ITU headquarters, Geneva, Switzerland, and goes on the list and list. I think so if I do this, we'll spend 10 minutes explaining his achievements in itself. We welcome Dr. Azim. Dr. Azim, I'll initial reaction on the union budget, and then I can move to the 2 to 3 questions which I have for you on the healthcare.
Thank you so much, Aditya, and thank you so much for a very long-winded introduction. I am humbled and honored. Thank you for ICC for inviting me. I think within the given constraints and the fact that there is an increase in fiscal deficit, the government has tried to balance multiple objectives. So I would give it a a positive outlook within the circumstances and the facts of whatever has happened in 2020 across the world. It could have been a bit more aggressive in outlays, and even I would say, contrary to what economists might think in terms of the credit rating in a scenario, this is a very, very different scenario that the world has faced last year. And a lot of leeway can be taken and could have been a bit more aggressive. But otherwise, I think it's tried to achieve multiple objectives within the fact that the resources are less.
And I'll vouch for your words, you know, because you've seen both sides of the coin. You know, you've been on the IS cadre. You've worked with the closely with the government. You've seen how difficult it is to manage things, and you've seen the entrepreneur side of it as well. So I'll vouch for your words. I'm just putting up a deck for you, and this is my question. And this, you know, and I keep on asking different people, because the government is saying that I did a trade-off over the last 8 to 9 months with an intense lockdown. And the trade-off was losing out on the economy for the first 8 to 9 months. So the fiscal deficit, what it stands today, is because of the intense lockdown, because everything came to a standstill, consumption, investment, all economic activity. And if you look at, are you able to see the screen?
Yeah, I am.
And in this regard, I'll let us skip the slide so the government claims that having not done, we would be on the red curve would have been the reality, where there would have been more cases, more deaths, but a lesser recession. Whereas they have need lesser cases, lesser deaths, but a more severity of recession. So I don't know whether the government is trying to justify the lockdown or justify the recession, that the recession is very normal. What it has achieved is something different. So how much, and if I look at the, and it's given examples of where there was no intense lockdown in that some of the advanced economies or some of the emerging economies, there's a first wave, there's a second wave. Whereas India has just covered its first wave, and there's the chances of a second wave are very limited. That's what it claims. With the vaccination around the corner, even if it is there, it is well prepared for it. It's beefed up its healthcare sector. So that's what it claims, the number of beds which are available, the number of testings which are happening. So, and obviously it's saying that we have beaten all expectations. So with the number of deaths which are expected, it's lesser vis-a-vis what was expected in US. It's a lot more deaths which have happened. So do you buy into this argument of the government that it was a very wise trade-off which it did? It saved lives, but at the cost of the economy, and it's all justified? Dr. Zee?
Yeah. So Aditya, I will give a nuanced answer to this. Very brief to begin with, I would say that there was no option before the government not to do a lockdown. Decisions are made with the best information available at a point of time. And there is no way, and there is no sensible course of action without a lockdown in a country like ours, as a viable policy perspective, even at the cost of economy. And this is the same, a country, same as an individual. You would rather lose your income than die. Period. It's as simple as that. So there is no question about in the scenario whether a lockdown was inevitable or not. It was inevitable. It had to be done. Now, question is whether that lockdown has led to lesser number of deaths exactly and all will be things which will have to be understood over a period of time. We are, despite almost a year having gone by, we are still learning new things about COVID on a daily basis. And we are still in the midst of it. Let us not mistake that. While all of us have got tired and businesses have opened up and things have eased down, what might happen in the future is still going to be studied. There is some amount of issues with our data and how much all deaths are recorded in India, especially in rural areas, and how many cases are all actually captured. having said that, the delta is not so big. So definitely Indian overall death with our population has been lower. Now, whether it is because of lockdown or because there are some other factors of immunity because of endemic infectious diseases, viral disease, we do not know as of today. But as a policy position, I would say the trade-off between economic losses and this is actually, from a public health perspective and national perspective, inevitable and had to be taken. Now, whether that can be boosted by much more stimulus as a ground, what else can be done is a different issue altogether, which we'll address, I think, during these discussions on the budget. But yes, I think on a sum, I would completely agree that the lockdown was inevitable. In fact, some of the things we could have done, migrant movement and all, managed better during the lockdown. So there were issues of implementation. There were issues of decisions, which in hindsight, it is very easy to take decisions in hindsight. Probably the movement could have been allowed much earlier. But that this is when you are groping in the dark. So you really do not have the luxury of perfect knowledge to take decisions. So I would say this part of the story is acceptable and livable, and we have to move on from here to see what can be done.
Yes, yes. Dr. Zim, you've been part of the administrative services for a long time. I'm sure in your whole lifetime with the administrative services, you would have never seen such, in any of the fields, any of the sectors, such a severity kind of a situation.
We have never seen, and in fact, I would say, let's look at the positive side of it. Neither in HIV, AIDS, nor any other thing which we have seen in our lives, and even a little bit prior to that, the world also has never concentrated and cooperated to the extent that we have seen across the world this time. So what we should be mindful of, the fact, while we may be ruining our businesses or the economic downfall or the problems that have occurred, is that in the 1920s, the flu pandemic actually took away 50 million people, and it took a long time to recover. The amount of unprecedented cooperation and activity that happened across the governments in the world is actually a very, very positive sign. And I would say that while we do lick our losses, our wounds, we must be thankful that we have all, by and large, survived.
But that is very, 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 very clear, and you know, it's not a one-sided answer. It's a very balanced answer which you gave. You've given both sides the perspective. Yes, they didn't manage the migrant issue. That was one pain, which I believe every Indian carries. When we've seen those scenes on the news channels, yes, that's a pain. But yes, what else could have the government have done? It had to go ahead with the lockdown. Now, coming to the next question, has it woken up the government? And not only in India, I believe across the world, have the governments woken up? I believe even in countries like US, they were also not prepared for something of this sort. And so is the government now going to be more conscious going forward? And I don't know whether you would be, your friends who are still part of the administrative services, you would be hearing from them. Is the government really serious about it? Because it says that I'm going to increase my budget by 137%, and which will bring down the expenditures by individuals and the whole story of this, where the possibility of when such a pandemic happens or such a severe disease happens, it pushes people into the poverty line because they're going to spend money on medical rather than basic necessities, or building houses, or educating their children. So it pushes people into poverty. But when I look at the budget numbers, which is there on this slide, the numbers are going from 94,000 to 2,23,000. But if I look at the constituents of it, there is a drinking water and sanitation, nutrition. So with all these components put together, actually, if you see the true constituents of, you know, health, you know, where you spend on hospitals and you spend on all of that, is not too much. It's still the same. It's hovering in the same number. Vaccination is a 110.35. So it's boasting of a very, thumping its chest of that in 21-22, I'm going to spend so much more. But will it be able to sustain this? Because I believe most of these are one time, and drinking water and sanitation is definitely not healthcare.
Aditya, you are absolutely right. You know, we are all completely confused as to where the Atmanirbhar scheme is going to get an outlay from. And now it is very, very suicidal to talk about your past, but the budget is always considered to be more like a public wishful statement. And it is the outlays which actually lay down what is going to be available for a particular activity in the year and the Finance Act per se. Now, here I don't see, so this is the unfortunate part. The first part I would say that the pandemic itself, with mistakes, with issues, and we can always criticize in hindsight, but I think the government took the right position, what was needed to be done at that point of time. But now coming out of it, there is a need for taking some of the things very, very seriously. And I'm a bit confused, where is that seriousness in the numbers? So as you very correctly said, and if you look at it, the NRHM, if you look at revised estimates, which are not here on the screen, the revised estimates for health and family welfare itself were, I think, around 77,000 crores. And therefore, the budget estimates of 21-22 are actually lower than the revised estimates. The fact that you could not utilize them completely because of the pandemic and things like that is a different matter altogether. The Aatmanirbhar scheme, where is it actually going to bring it? Bring the money from, where is the outlay? I don't see that here. And classifying health as health and well-being and bringing in drinking water and sanitation, nobody is doubting that drinking water and sanitation is important. No question about it. But it is not the preventive and the curative care which you require to build your own resilient systems. And if you look further into details, which is not here on the screen, the number of even the centers in the urban primary healthcare centers, rural healthcare centers, those numbers targeted are also very, very low. So I would say that 2,23,000 crores vis-a-vis 94,000 is more a classifying exercise. Now, on the other side, what probably needs to be questioned, and this is where economists and all will weigh in and say, no, we can't do that, is that where is the money going to come from? So while you announce that, see, you don't have a choice in vaccination. Vaccines have always been free as part of the universal immunization program in India for decades and decades. And if a disease like COVID comes in, it is obviously an essential part. So you had to pump that money. Now the question is that they have gone up on the fiscal deficit. Now more probably they didn't want to go. So I would say this seems to me only status quo as of today with some incrementalism. I do not see a bold healthcare statement here in this budget.
So the thumping of the chest, you know, that what's going to boost the economy is the spend on the healthcare, spend on the infra. At least the spend on the healthcare is, we don't know the true picture behind it.
Yeah.
In this context, I will like to mention that Sri Lanka, for example, has incomes. You know, we should replicate Sri Lanka. The health expenditure to GDP is much lower in India than countries like Sri Lanka. You know, so we could actually pump in a lot more. You know, our percentage expenditure as a health expenditure as percentage of GDP is low, and it is desirable that we pump in a lot more expenditure than we currently do now. Thank you.
No, absolutely, Professor Gupta. The point is, this is the whole point that Aditya was actually trying to bring out, is where is the real money? Where is it? And whether we could have gone up on fiscal deficit and had actually increased it would have been, I think, the only point when credit ratings won't matter is in the COVID and post-COVID scenario. And here, I think aggression would have been much more useful across the world. If one country does expenditure beyond its means at a point of time, it would be considered fiscally irresponsible. But when there is a pandemic in the world, at that point of time, coming out, funding it in any form whatsoever, and creating a stimulus as well as expenditure on healthcare would have been just the right time to do it, and nobody would have actually questioned it.
The concern,
please, Mr. Professor Gupta.
The concern is that, you know, I mean, it is not that, you know, if the government does it. See, if there, you know, as economists would say, if there are unutilized resources and the government does increased expenditure, then it's fine, you know. So, you know, it's having what is called a multiplier effect. However, if resources are limited, then, you know, your expenditures, if the government, you know, does too much of an expenditure, then interest rates increase and private investment would shrink to a certain extent, and therefore the private sector investment shrinks. That is where the concern is. If the government spends too much, does it crowd out, you know, private investment is what is the concern for economists, you know. Obviously, you know, if it is on health and that's precisely the reason. See, if you invest in infrastructure and roads and things, you know, there's a direct employer, you know, income generating thing that you can foresee. The thing that you don't foresee immediate outcomes in health is that, you know, you don't find immediate positive effect. That is the problem why governments are reluctant to spend on health.
Professor Gupta, at the risk of, please stop me, Aditya, if we are shooting out our time. But let me just point out, Professor Gupta, one point very clearly. You see, this is not in doubt today, and this data is very, very clear that the high out-of-pocket expenditure on healthcare leads to about 3 to 3.3% of population in India falling below the poverty line. Now, that is a larger damage than the positive side.
Agreed completely.
Second point I would like to point out is that if you look at NSSO figures in terms of the average cost of healthcare, both primary and secondary across private and public in the country, and which includes a huge amount of poor population, which is not spending at all, the cost is about 650 per episode of primary care and about 25,000 average for hospitalization. If you look at that, if you are taking care of 70% of the rural population under NRHM and NHM, the NUHM, the urban poor, then the amount that you need is actually 3,930 rupees. And your expenditure is actually one third of that. So you really don't have the resources to run the centers as per your own data. And that is where we are not talking about increasing. We are talking about where is the money to run these primary healthcare centers, CHCs and PHCs, as per the current costs of NSSO. That's the point I'm making.
Agreed.
For want of time, I will move to the next question. And this is to you, Dr. Azeem. As you are also an entrepreneur today. So as an entrepreneur, the question around ease of doing business, whether in the healthcare sector, so if there's a private player who wants to set up an hospital, the number of licenses it has got to take, and if it wants to wind up at any point of time. So, and this is something which has been acknowledged in the economic survey report, that India suffers from overregulation. And it says that for a simple striking off a company from the register of companies, which has got any litigation, it takes more than 1500 days. And if I look at the ease of doing business ranking, we are lagging behind in the starting a business or registering a property. Similarly, when we see, I agree, we have improved from 130 to 63 today, or 120, 125, we are somewhere around that. And we are on the ease of doing business ranking, we are 63. But their chances of us improving any further are not going to be there, because these are the two biggest constituents where government is not able to do much. And this is where and so this is not from a healthcare perspective, but yes, indirectly linked, that if hiring plays a time, set up shop is the ease of doing business. Because I know in your kind of a sector, the number of licenses are innumerable. You have to take a host of licenses, approvals, and got on a host of other things. So Dr. Azeem, your view on this?
So Aditya, I think it is not that things haven't improved over the past 10, 20 years. things have definitely improved. Some of the licenses have been scrapped. I remember in my childhood, there used to be a license for a radio and a cycle also. So when I was very, very young. So I think things have improved, but definitely we are certainly not there where you could say that vis-a-vis to the developmental growth in the economy, the friction that you need to reduce has actually come down. In healthcare, of course, there are innumerable licenses. And more than that, there is actually, apart from that, the problem in for every entrepreneur, not just in healthcare, is that a lot of laws do not actually make sense, because we don't, when we introduce a law, we don't introduce sunset clauses that, you know, at this point it will expire on its own unless revalidated. So you have a situation where, supposing you want to apply for a Clinical Establishment Act license, you have to submit the details of all the employees that you already have, the equipment and the building that you have. And the time that it will take will be at least 30 to 90, 60 days. And so who will pay the salary of all those people for 60 days? Unless you expect that it is implicitly understood that people will run a hospital without a license. So the basic thing, there are three, four things which are very, very basic, which need to be done and which can be a cross sector. One part is that any license or regulation that is required on application should be deemed to have been approved. And for false declaration and affidavits, there must be penal action for it. It's a simple way to reduce this. And if you remember that India has done this massive passport seva part where they have the police verification, they've actually removed the pain of people. Now, if the economy is to be grown by businesses and industries and entrepreneurs, this is the least that an easier step that the government should be able to do for across all. And you need to have only one act enabling provision for all, covering all acts, that any application or license on applied for will be deemed to have been given unless proven otherwise, and then have a penal provision. So we are a long way from this place. And judicial is a very, very big topic that you want to touch. And I would, both for the sake of my own safety and sanity, would remain away from it.
Thank you, Dr. Azeem. Very good insight. Your experience is so rich. I'm sure the whole audience has learned a lot today. You got a different perspective. And I'll again reiterate the word, a very balanced perspective. You were critical about certain things. You were appreciative about certain things. And you were recognizing the circumstances in which the current government is. Just not putting the blame on them, but yes, also highlighting that they could have done a little more. Thank you, Dr. Azeem. We'll do the next session. If you want, you can be there, or you can even, I know.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Saluk, I think so. We'll now move to the session.
For that, I must thank Dr. Azeem for sharing his views on this budget, because he is from the field. He has got two sides of his views. One is bureaucratic, one is as entrepreneur. So we had a real time view from him on the budget. Anyway, now we'll move to our next main item. That is the
yes.
Explanation or detailed analysis of the direct and indirect tax by Dhubo Advisors and LLP team, which will be basically done by Mr. Aditya Hans, partner, Dhubo Advisors LLP, Mr. Ranjit Mahatani, partner, Dhubo Advisors LLP, and Mr. Bashant Gandhian, principal, Dhubo Advisors LLP. Now I would request Mr. Aditya Hans to take the lead and let us have their views.
Thank you, Mr. Chattopadhyay. Basant, would you care to put up the presentation? Please put up the presentation, Basant. I have to stop sharing. Okay. Yeah. You can just move to the macroeconomic slide. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. The way we would run this session would be, I would take around 8 to 10 minutes giving a summary and touching upon the critical points. My colleague Basan would discuss certain elements in there which are there in the fine print, followed by Ranjit, who would discuss more issues, because I think the custom is, there have been some changes in the customs and some changes in the GST. Rather, I would say the changes in the GST are smart and tactical. Government is becoming wiser. And I think so the legal fraternity and the chartered accountant fraternity is making them wiser by the day with the writs which we file challenging their regulations. So with an element of humor, I thought I'll put that up. This is the first budget of this decade. As we start the decade, the first budget, also labeled as one of the century budget, once in a century budget of India. That's the way it was being, you know, the drum was being beaten, that once in a century budget. Well, I thought, you know, anyone would have thought that there'll be so many announcements, so many things which will come up. But I think so it was once in a century budget that there were very limited announcements. That's why it was once in a century. Reason being that with such a huge fiscal deficit, which everyone was expecting, they were supposed to be with the tax rates, tax collections, but nothing happens. So actually, in effect, it is once in a century budget of India with not much changes affecting the taxpayers directly. Indirectly, read the fine print, there are hidden elements which actually take away taxes or collect more taxes. And we'll discuss that in the subsequent slides. The Union Budget of 2021 has come in the backdrop of the largest GDP contraction that India has suffered post-independence. If one were to rate the budget, considering the market reactions over the last 2 days, equity, currency, bonds have given one of the highest post-budget thumbs up. While this is primarily because of the many proposals in the Union Budget 2021-22, it is also because of many of the proposals which were anticipated which did not come. So the hardship which the government could have imposed, it appears to have not imposed. That's why the optimism. The government followed a consultative approach. I must really appreciate that. All because we are part of many of the chambers of commerce and you know, tax bodies. We made representations. Everyone made representations. Many of them have found a place in the union budget. Actually, clarifying things, sorting of things, and also there were certain things which we didn't ask for. The government went ahead and clarified, which actually took away some of the tax benefits which many of the taxpayers were availing. So it is indeed a thought through budget. Hello. It's indeed a thoughtful budget, envisioning solutions on a number of issues. It's aggressive in its approach of funding one of the highest fiscal deficits to non-tax rates. Banali, could you just put yourself on mute? Continuing its push towards minimum government and maximum governance, the government announced that most of the government measures will be technology driven, like both direct and indirect taxation, making most of it faceless. The process started last year, and it's putting a final nail in the coffin by extending it to the tribunal, probably the settlement commission, the advance ruling. I think so all of it may become faceless at some point of time. Even a dispute resolution mechanism, which has been set for low tax issues for people with lower income up to 50 lakhs, that also intended to be faceless. Significant announcements also have been made in customs, trying to push this agenda of Make in India. Some places they have messed it up. Some places they have achieved that. Where will the money come from if it is not coming from tax revenues? Divestment of 2 public sector banks and a general insurance company, enhancing the FDI limit in the insurance sector. Okay, that's not where the collections are going to come up. But it's going to encourage FDI limit in the insurance sector. That's where money will come into India. And to give comfort, you know, to push in the cause of more of LLPs and more forms of structure in which people can do, and not the conventional private limited company, public limited company, or a pure. They have
criminalized
digital offenses for limited liability partnerships. They are also permitting NRIs to invest in one-person companies, which will enable NRIs, you know, having some good idea and coming and doing business in India. It'll encourage that process more. So high net worth NRIs wanting to come and do business, wanting to stay away from the compliance hassles, significant compliance hassles of a public limited or a private limited company, they can go for the scheme. Some positive proposals from the budget on direct tax for the common man with respect to easing of compliances include scrapping of income tax return for senior citizens having pension, just having pension and interest income, deferring payment of advance taxes in case of dividend income, as it has an element of uncertainty. Standing today in the month of June, I don't know the dividends. Dividends generally come in different periods. They come in June, July, August, and then they come again in the months of Feb, March. So you cannot anticipate that. All these measures are surely a right foot forward in the direction of the minimum government and maximum governance, which the government is promising. It did realize that the COVID has impacted the real estate sector, and they were wanting to build this portfolio of affordable housing, that up to 45 lakhs houses can be bought by lower income or middle income class people. So they had brought out a scheme where there were advantages to the buyer, there were advantages to the builder, there was also an opportunity where a variation between the circle rate and the actual rate at which the transaction happens between the builder and the buyer, it was a permissible. Otherwise, there would have been a deemed taxation. So there's been a relaxation on that. All of this till 2022. So government has realized that not much economic activity happened in 2021. So I need to give a little more time. So it's extended by 1 year and expecting to be a good response. Rather, I've spoken to many people in the real estate sector who are working on affordable housing. They welcome this move in a big way. Government wants to actually put its NHI and all those infrastructures which it does into the REITs and InvITs, bring in funding, and to ease that process, there was a tax, double taxation element which was happening, or a tax cost which was getting created. So it solved that riddle as well as with respect to REITs and InvITs. So that's a very welcome move. So we will get to see more of the REITs and the InvITs and investments into REITs and InvITs. Because if you're going to do, your government is talking about a lot of infra spend, but all of it cannot come from the government. So they're also going to channelize funds from private sector, from foreign funds, and their spend itself. So a smart move, I must say that. But, you know, government is slowly and slowly taking away a lot of benefits which were there for good, you know, well-salaried class people who are in the range of 25, 30, 40 lakhs, 50 lakhs. It's slowly and slowly taking away those benefits. Like, it got wind of the idea that high net worth individuals, or not high net, highly paid individuals in the salaried people, they used to allocate a significant amount to the employer's contribution. So government went ahead and put a cap beyond which it would be taxed. The limit was 7.5 lakhs last year. This is something, a change which they brought in last year. Then it got a wind that, okay, I'm now going to tax the employee's contribution beyond 7.5 lakhs. What about the employee's contribution? Well, that's normally taxable beyond a particular time amount. So what about the interest which is coming? Because the interest which is going to come on that is going to be at a higher rate. So they have put a cap also, just like in a public provident fund, there is a 1.5 lakh. So here they put in a 2.5 lakhs. The only thing is you can put a value beyond 2.5 lakhs, but that will be then the interest accruing out of it will be taxable. So they have been smart. So all those tax plannings which we have been doing for decades actually, since the time probably I got into a job, but it's plugging in all those. And I just hope that government becomes wiser and finally, when it's plugged in all the opportunities for an individual, where it was doing some element, because some time back it was on housing loans also, it's plugged that opportunity also, where we used to buy loans and take interest, the deduction on the interest which we are paying on those loans, that has also been capped. Employer's contribution has been capped. I don't know, where does a salaried person now put in or do his tax planning? So it's simply taking the income And again, if you see last year, they gave the two options, moving into a new regime, you don't do any tax planning. Just go by a simple rate. We'll give you some advantages out there. So it's probably moving in a direction because the companies are paying a 25% tax rate. Individuals with salaries of higher income are paying taxes at the rate of 33-34%. There was some element of tax planning. So it's wanting that these taxpayers pay a proper straight away 34-35%, and probably then it'll strike it down to 25% at some point of time. So all those opportunities where taxes were not being paid, it's trying to plug in those. The ULIP also. ULIP was another opportunity which the government has plugged in this time again. So from an individual perspective, not so good a story, but the only good thing is that they didn't have a surcharge or a cess for in relation to COVID. That's the only good news which I can say from an individual's perspective. From a corporate perspective, I don't know whether to call it a dampener or whether to call it clarificatory, but what they have done is finally that the goodwill which was being generated when you acquired a business asset, when you acquired a company, so the arbitrage which was there between the book net worth and the actual value which you were paying, that arbitrage which was there, that was considered as intangibles, split between the registered recorded intangibles and goodwill. And a rightful depreciation was being claimed. But there was mischief being done by many of the individuals, by many of the companies, where they were trying to do this and achieve this, even though accounting standards were restricting this to a large extent. But through smart planning techniques, they were trying to take advantage of this. To put a check to this, government scrapped the whole concept of depreciation on goodwill. So I think so, to put a check to not so legitimate transactions, planning transactions which could have been arrested by GAR, instead of it just scrapped the whole concept, not appreciative. So rather, I think so the largest acquisition which have happened in the last 2 years, goodwill was a very certain because it was supported by a Supreme Court ruling. Rather interestingly, in the memorandum it's discussed the Supreme Court ruling and done so that it will not do it going forward. It is done it in a smarter way. It's not confirmed that all goodwill deductions which have been claimed in the past, they are legitimate, but it's remained silent on it. But some people read it in a manner that it is legitimate. Therefore, what you have done till 1920. So there are a variety of interpretations. One interpretation is that if you've already recorded your goodwill to 1920, you're rightful to take it going forward. Some is that what you have done till 1920 is done. You cannot, even the recorded goodwill of 17, 18, 18, 19 or 1920, you cannot take it going forward. Some say that if you have recorded till 1920, it can be taken going forward. So there are different set of interpretations which are there. And I think so the government will come up with clarification, but at least if it does so, if it takes away the right retrospectively, then it's beating, you know, it's just going back to the earlier government's regime, you know, the approach of doing retrospective, not calling it retrospective, but the action is a retrospective. On the GST front, the finance minister said that the record, yes, there have been record collection, 1,20,000 crores. That's a wonderful whooping amount. Since the start of the GST, we have not reached those numbers. Several measures have been taken to further simplify the GST. Deep use of analytics, artificial intelligence are helping them identify tax evaders. You would have all read the papers over the last 1 year, 1.5 years. So those fake credits and all of that and fake invoices, a lot of it has been plugged, and through artificial intelligence, they are able to capture, because a seamless flow of credit, whenever there's a break in the chain, or anything of that happens, or suddenly there's a credit which is getting created, or there's a corresponding which you're not able to find it. So through your artificial intelligence and now correlating it with the income tax returns also, the government is very optimistic that it will be able to weed out corruption and weed out these false, illegitimate, fake invoices, which were actually not legitimate credits. There's been a proposed amendment in Section 16 of the CGST Act, which provides that ITC on invoice or debit note can only be availed when the details of such invoice or debit note have been furnished by the supplier in the statement of outward supplies, and such details have been communicated to the recipient of such invoice. debit note appears to be an attempt to overcome the argument. So you know, it's been a trend that you put in something in the rules and then you come. Because it's a learning process. GST is a learning process. The government is learning by the month and it brings in the amendment in the rule. And the fraternity of lawyers, they come up and challenge that, saying that it's not part of the act, that's not enshrined in the act. You cannot just amend the rule and put in and implement something. So to this time, the government, as I said, has been very smart and tactical of making many of these amendments which are there earlier part of the rules or which are envisaged to be part of the rules, made it as a part of the act. So saving a lot of the writs time which would have spent fighting it out with the lawyers in the courts, it's been a very smart and tactical. So I must appreciate they've been smart, getting smarter by today. So with this, to discuss all the provisions and details, I would like to invite my colleague Basant, who will discuss some of the provisions in detail on direct tax, and followed by Ranjit. Basant, over to you.
Many thanks, Aditya, and thank you ICC for allowing us to do this session. Moving straight forward to the changes in the direct tax side, as you know, we have been recovering from the pandemic, and there has been a good return from the markets in the last 6 to 8 months. There has been a lot of apprehensions that there would be some kind of a new levy in terms of maybe increase in the security transaction tax or a revamp of the capital gains tax, which the market was fearing, apart from any COVID kind of a cess in order to recover the shortfall, which the fiscal deficit shortfall with the government is potentially going to face. However, as Aditya also mentioned, no bad news is a good news, and that is why everybody is cheerful in terms of how the markets have reacted.
Basant, we are not able to hear you. Basant? Just one second. I'm just checking with Basant. Just one second. I'm sorry, there's a technology problem. This person will be joining once again. Just give us 2 minutes. Yeah, I would just let my colleague, but I probably there's a challenge in his laptop. I'll just ask my colleague Basant to step in.
Yeah, please, Basant. Thank you, Aditya, and very sorry for this tech glitch. There is some issue with my laptop. Just to resume, while there was apprehensions where there could be a new levy of tax in terms of an increased cess or maybe a wealth tax, or a revamped kind of increase in STT or a capital gains tax. However, the government has played is quite smart in terms of not introducing any new kind of tax for any of the taxpayers. And there's been no increase in any tax rate also. So this is where the market has responded quite positively. And the Indian Inc. is also quite cheerful in terms of the changes which has come in into the budget. However, when we go to the fine print, there are obviously certain areas where indirectly there has been some backdoor entry for increasing certain taxes in certain transactions, or you know, unsettling the settled principles for certain levies, which was not considered as taxable in first place from quite some time. To start with, if I may say so, the depreciation on goodwill, which has been the much talked about change, which has come yesterday. So just taking a step back, there was a Supreme Court decision in the case of Smith Securities, which upheld that goodwill is an intangible asset, which is eligible for depreciation, although it does not particularly find place specifically as one of the specified assets eligible for depreciation under the Act. So all along over the years, SSE has been claiming the benefit of depreciation on goodwill, which was acquired on their restructuring transactions like mergers, demergers, slump sale. And following the Supreme Court decision, there had been a lot of high courts and tribunal decisions also, which had blessed this the claim of depreciation on goodwill to the taxpayers. Now what the change which is proposed is that from financial year 2021 itself, which is from 1st April 20 itself, the depreciation claim on goodwill would not be allowed for any purposes. However, for computing the cost of acquisition for goodwill, for capital gains purposes, the value of goodwill will be considered. However, again, that value will be calculated net of any depreciation which the SSE would have claimed earlier. So for instance, if there is a depreciation which the SSE has already claimed in the last 3-4 years, and there is a cost of acquisition for a business to be transferred subsequently, which has goodwill in itself, in those cases, the cost of goodwill would be considered the acquisition price less the goodwill depreciation which has already been claimed by the taxpayer till financial year 1920. And of course, from financial year 2021, which is the current running year, which is just about to complete, the depreciation claim on goodwill has been categorically disallowed. And it has been specifically mentioned that depreciation would not be available in any manner whatsoever. There is one gray area also in terms of the memorandum being silent in terms of what could be the fallout of the goodwill depreciation which is claimed for the past years by the SSEs, and we hope that only time will tell that as to how the department would take its stand, but we are sure there are many representations which are going to go to the finance minister on this unsettling the claim of depreciation on goodwill, so to say. Next, there is a concept of deduction for employees contribution on provident fund. If you see section 36(1)(5) of the Income Tax Act, which the scheme of the act says that whenever there is a deduction for on behalf of the employee, which the employer is supposed to pay to the PF authorities, being the contribution, employee's contribution to PF, there had been decisions which suggested that where there is a delay in deposit of such employee contribution by the employer beyond the prescribed due date under the PF Act, such deduction was still allowable to the employer up to the date of filing the return of income by the employer. Meaning thereby, if there was any PF which was supposed to be paid for the month of March, but it was paid within the due date of filing the employer's return of income, meaning thereby October or November, as the case may be, even in such cases, the employer was eligible to get the deduction for such employees' contribution to PF. However, what the change now is proposed is that the FM has categorically said that the intention was not so, because this money always belonged to the employee, and by using this money, the employer is unjustly benefited. So if there is any delay by the employer in paying the employee contribution to PF and other superannuation funds within the prescribed timeline, there will be a permanent disallowance in the hands of the employer, which means the employer would never be allowed to claim a deduction if there is a delay of even a single day of employee's contribution to PF fund. And it has also been clarified that section 43B of the Act would not apply, which provides deduction on payment basis. Moving next, there have been a rationalization in the MAT provisions for foreign companies and also for residents. Since the scheme of taxation of dividends was changed from last year, where the incidence of tax was shifted from the company to the shareholder receiving the dividend, foreign companies receiving dividend where the rate of tax under the treaty was lower than the applicable MAT rate, which is 15%, there was no provision in the Act to reduce that dividend income for MAT computation purposes. Now, this is a welcome change where it has been now clarified and inserted in the provisions that dividend income would be reduced for the purpose of book profit for foreign companies where the tax rate is lower than the MAT rate. This treatment is in line with other income of the foreign companies, like they earn in the form of interest, royalties, fees for technical services. Also, where there are transfer pricing adjustments and secondary adjustments and the AP related adjustments which happen, there is no clawback provisions in the MAT provisions, which allow to adjust the past year income of book profits. These provisions have now been made enabled, and the SSE can now adjust the past year's income with respect to secondary adjustment and adjustments which arise out of the APA. Moving further, one very principal change apart from the goodwill which has been announced yesterday is towards taxability of retirement and reconstitution or dissolution of partners from the partnership firm or by the members of an association of person or body of individuals. Just to give a background, there were no codified provisions under the Income Tax Act for taxing any retirement or reconstitution of a partnership firm where partner used to retire from the firm and the manner in which the exit used to happen. However, now the FM has brought in provisions by introducing and by scrapping the existing section 45(4) and revamping that section and bringing another 45(4)A section by taxing such transactions wherever there is a reconstitution of a firm and retirement of a partner, and there is a capital asset which is distributed by the partnership firm to the partner. The capital asset so distributed, which corresponds to the capital balance of the partner in the firm, is taxable in the hands of not the partner, but the partnership firm. So this is a tax which has to be discharged by the partnership firm and not by the partner. Over and above the capital balance standing in the partner's capital account, if there is any other asset or any actual cash which is distributed by the partnership firm to the retiring partner, in those cases, that excess is also subject to tax, again, in the hands of the partnership firm. One point to be noted here is that any revaluation of any asset or any self-generated goodwill will have to be ignored for all these purposes. Logically, very true, as it would go to bring down the incidence of tax in the hands of the partnership firm. And since there is no prescribed mechanism for valuing the capital asset, which would be distributed to the partner at the time of retirement, the proposed law provides that the fair market value of the capital asset would be deemed to be the full value of consideration which is received by the partner. The manner in which the full value of the consideration, market value of the consideration would be determined has not been prescribed as of now, but we hope that it could be more in line with other provisions of the Act, where market value, fair market value of different assets and properties are determined. Moving ahead, one more significant change which has come in terms of taxing a transaction, which is a slump exchange. This manner of undertaking transactions of slump exchange in the garb of slump sale was something which a lot of SSEs had been doing. And there had in fact been decisions by various ITATs and in fact high courts where it has been held that where there was a transaction of slump exchange, which means that an undertaking is sold to someone for consideration, which is not in manner of cash, but in the manner of any non-cash transactions. For example, where a business is sold and in exchange shares or bonds or preference shares or equity shares is issued. So there is no cash element involved in the consideration. So this matter is presently sub judice before the Supreme Court in terms of whether this slump exchange would be taxable in the hands of the seller. A very smart change which has been introduced is by changing the definition of slump sale itself to include that slump sale would include exchange. So meaning thereby, if there is any transaction, whether where an undertaking is transferred, whether it involves cash or it does not involve cash, those transactions would be taxable as slump sale, even though they are termed as a slump exchange. So there had been various arguments in terms of saying as to why such slump exchange would not be taxable based on relying on the underlying sale of goods act and the legislative history when slump sale was brought into the statute. But now all of this has been overturned by bringing an amendment in the definition section of section 242C itself by changing the meaning of slump sale, so to say. So these are some of the changes where, you know, some of the interpretations have been done away with, and these have been brought into the tax net, whether in terms of taxing slump exchange or disallowing goodwill depreciation. Moving ahead, there are some incentive which has also been given for the FPIs, and more so because FPIs drive our capital markets. Last year, as everybody is aware, that there was a withholding tax on dividend because the incidence of tax was shifted on dividends to the shareholder from the company as the DDT was abolished. However, the provisions of the Income Tax Act was worded in such a manner that while the Indian company was making remittance of dividend to the foreign portfolio investors, they were supposed to withhold tax at the prescribed rate of 20% because the Income Tax Act did not allow them to take the treaty benefit, which was subsequently also held by the Calcutta High Court and then by the Supreme Court in the PILCOM ruling. Now this is a very welcome change which has been brought, where the tax withholding on dividend payments to FPIs would be at a rate which is either the 20% prescribed rate under the Act or the treaty rate, which is generally lower in all the cases. So there will be no cash leakage in terms of suffering the withholding tax or claiming refund by the FPIs to the extent of dividend income, which is concerned. At the same time, there was also a tax deduction at source on the dividend income, which was received by business trusts, which was formed as REITs and InvITs. For them also, it has now been clarified, and a welcome change has been made from April 2020 itself, that there would be no withholding tax on payments of dividend to REITs and InvITs. Moving ahead, there are some procedural changes which has now been introduced with respect to TDS. I may not categorize this as a more of a procedural change, but this is much of a substantial change. Like last year, there was a provision with respect to tax collected at source at the rate of 0.1% on specified transactions. Now, this TCS, which was brought in last year, has now been replaced by TDS, where again, this TDS provisions will kick in whenever there is a buyer who is purchasing goods from anyone for value, purchasing any goods from a person for a value which exceeds 50 lakh rupees. And all those buyers would be required to withhold tax at the rate of 0.1% on such transactions. And in case the seller does not furnish the PAN, there is a penultimate higher rate of 5%, which the buyer can apply at the time of making payment for such purchases. Interestingly, there is no such clarification or carve out with respect to non-residents. Like in case, suppose where there are non-residents who happen to be the buyer and they are buying from an Indian person, how all these provisions would be implemented, whether the non-resident would also be liable to deduct tax at the rate of 0.1%. At the same time, there has also been some reference to TCS provisions of 2061H with this provision of TDS, where it has been clarified that, you know, whenever the transactions is covered under other provisions of the TDS or by 2061H, it will now be replaced by the new TDS provisions which is brought in under section 194Q of the Income Tax Act. At the same time, to ensure that people are compliant in terms of filing the return of income timely, and we'll also discuss that the timelines of the returns of income have been squeezed further. There is a higher rate of TDS withholding at the twice the applicable rates or 5% from 1st July 2021 in case where the person for whom the tax is required to be withheld under TDS or TCS, as the case may be, has not filed its return of income for the past 2 years, and the timeline for filing such tax return has also been lapsed. So in such cases, what would happen in, so this is something where, you know, there would be practical difficulties in implementing such transactions, where, you know, for each and every TDS or TCS compliance, the buyer in case of TDS would have to approach the seller and ask whether or obtain a declaration, so to say, that whether the tax return has been filed for the last 2 years and they are not pending, because as of now there is no prescribed mechanism to online check as to whether the person to whom these provisions are applied have actually filed his return of income or not within the prescribed times. Moving ahead to the next slide. As we mentioned, there are some rationalization in the due dates for filing of tax returns. So slowly and steadily, as the years are progressing, we have seen that the timelines for filing returns of income are getting squeezed. Earlier, there used to be an era where 2 years were allowed to file belated or revised return of income. However, now as the law stands as of today, the SSC gets 12 months from the end of the financial year to file a revised or a belated return. Going forward, this 12 months time is further curtailed by 3 months, which means that a person can file his return of income, a belated return or a revised return within December following next of the financial year. So assuming this act is passed obviously by the parliament, for financial year 2021, the outer limit for filing a revised or a belated return would fall as December 31st, 2021. At the same time, there is one change which has been brought in for firms and LLPs which are subject to transfer pricing, a very logical change where the partner's return would fall due on October. However, the return of the firm would fall due on November. So they have extended the timelines in the hands of the partners whose firms are subject to transfer pricing and said that their due date, the partner's return due date would be extended to 30th November of the respective assessment year. In line with the due dates for filing tax returns, there has also been a reduction in the time limit for issuance of notices and completing assessments by the tax department. This is all happening because of the automation and the availability of data which the department has through various sources, where it is far easier, and because of the faceless assessments, it is quite possible to complete the assessments and issue notices very quickly. So thus the earlier time limit of summary assessments, the scrutiny assessment notices, where the earlier timeline was 6 months from the end of the relevant financial year, has been squeezed by 3 months to make it only 3 months from the end of relevant financial year. Also for completion of tax assessments, for tax assessment, it's now 9 months from the end of the relevant assessment year by which the scrutiny assessments for AY 2021 have now to be completed. So these are in terms of reducing the timelines for returns and assessment by the tax department. Moving ahead, there is a very welcome change in terms of Section 147 of the Income Tax Act, which deals with reassessments. We are aware that the present law as it stands, it provides for reopening of assessments within a period of 4 years or for 6 years where, you know, the income falling escaping assessment is more than a lakh. And obviously there is a outer limit for foreign assets and all for 16 years. Now what the FM has proposed is that to give certainty to the taxpayers in terms of not facing any reassessments after having completed the scrutiny assessments, the reassessment timelines have been squeezed to 3 years. And at the same time, only in cases where there is a serious tax evasion the timelines have been kept at 10 years, also with a threshold that the income escaping assessment should be more than 50 lakh rupees in that case. So only in cases where the income escaping assessment is more than 50 lakh rupees and there is a case of serious tax evasion, the timeline for reopening of assessment has been extended to 10 years. And if we go to the fine print of the memorandum, what the memorandum suggests is that since there is already an inbuilt mechanism of the department to come up with a for the risk mitigation strategies, they have their own parameters to select in terms of which by which parameter the AO would decide that it is a case of a serious tax evasion. And it says that the AO should have an evidence of the income escaping assessment. Only then he can initiate a case of serious tax evasion. Otherwise, he may not have an opportunity to initiate any serious tax evasion case. At the same time, unlike the present scheme of the Act, for initiating such reassessments, the AO needs to take a prior approval from the principal commissioner or principal chief commissioner. And he is also supposed to provide an opportunity to the taxpayer even before issuing such reassessment notice. So this is a very welcome and a very transparent change which has been brought in this budget yesterday, which will give more certainty to the taxpayers and obviously to the foreign entities who are doing business in India in terms of getting some certainty with respect to the tax assessments. A connected change on these lines is with respect to the search cases. So all the search cases which are dealt with 153A and 153C, which are initiated till the end of this financial year, which is 31st of March 2021, shall continue to be implemented as per the present scheme. However, post 31st March 2021, or the search cases would not be there, and it would shift to the non-search case scheme where the reassessment regarding changes which we just discussed would apply. So this is a very welcome change which has been brought in terms of to reduce the litigation of the taxpayers and also to ensure that there is certainty in taxes and ease of doing business by the entities in India. Moving ahead, equalization levy, which was introduced last year and which had various technical and teething issues on its own. There has been some clarification which has been brought in by the government yesterday in terms of clarifying that wherever the transaction is subject to royalty or FTS under the Income Tax Act or a respective DTA, it would not be subject to an equalization levy. Earlier, there was an overlap where transaction could be categorized in both the places, either a royalty FTS or an equalization levy. So this is a very welcome change which has been brought in. At the same time, the exemption under Income Tax Act, as per the fine print of last year and the post last year's budget documents, it suggested that an income tax exemption was available only from 1st April 2021. However, this error has been rectified in this year's budget document to say that the Exemption and Income Tax Act would apply and it would date back to 1st April 2020 and not from April 21. Having said so, there is obviously a scope widening of the online sales of goods and online provision of services, and equalization levy has now become applicable irrespective of whether the e-commerce operator is owning the goods or providing the services on its own, or it's just facilitating such services. So the scope of the equalization levy has been widened and provided some clarity and relief with respect to royalty FTS and exemption correction on the exemption date under the Income Tax Act. for startups, this change of extension of 1 year is quite welcome, where the last date of incorporating a startup has been pushed from 31st March 21 to 31st March 22. At the same time, where the capital gain used to arise on sale of residential property, and that capital gains was eligible to be invested in an eligible startup, the date for sale of property was 31st March 2021. This date has also been extended by 1 year to 31st March 2022, meaning thereby where any the long-term capital gain arises from sale of residential property, the SSE has an option to put in the money into an eligible startup to get an exemption from the long-term capital gains tax. Going by the agenda of the government to disinvest public sector companies, there are also some exemptions which are given in the Income Tax Act now in terms of the losses and the date up to which the company is ceding to the public company, and the merged company will be eligible for migration on a merger carry out post disinvestment. Obviously, there are certain conditions which are attached for availing such kind of exemption for the public sector companies. Another change which has been brought in is by way of scrapping the authority for advance ruling. The rationale given in the memorandum is that there have been a lot of cases which have been piled before the AARs, and the AARs are not serving purpose because the positions of the AARs, the member who are supposed to be the retired judges of the Supreme Court and the High Court, the positions are lying vacant in the authority for advance ruling. So the AAR will now cease to operate, and in place of that, there is a board for advance ruling which has now been introduced, where there will be no requirement of retired judges to be appointed as members to adjudicate the board for advance ruling. There has been and all the detailed procedures and all have been enlisted in the fine print. At the same time, the Income Tax Settlement Commission has been discontinued, and there will be an interim board which will be constituted to settle the pending cases. Going in line with the digitization and the faceless schemes which are already there for assessments and appeals before the Commissioner Appeals, as well as the faceless penalty scheme, which was notified very recently, the government now wants to take the ITAT proceedings also faceless, and it would be launched by the government, and scheme would be notified in terms of how the faceless scheme before the ITAT would work. So it would be a dynamic kind of a faceless scheme where any person sitting in any part of the country may represent, and the judges may also not have to travel. The bench members would also not have to travel. So we'll have to wait for the fine print to come of this faceless assessment, a faceless scheme for ITAT, which is supposed to be launched. In line with the Vivad Se Vishwas, which is already running, and the date has also been extended now, there is a scheme for small taxpayers which has been launched, where the taxpayers whose return income is less than 50 lakhs and the aggregate amount of the variation which is proposed in the assessment is not more than 10 lakhs, they have a chance to opt for a dispute resolution mechanism for small taxpayers, as they call it, because a dispute resolution committee will be set up, which will have the powers to listen to the grievances of the small taxpayers where they fall into the eligible criteria of income and variation in tax assessment. And what the memorandum suggests is that the dispute resolution committee would have the power to reduce or waive the penalty and also give immunization from the prosecution proceedings as of now. But we hope that there will be other clarification which will flow from the CBDT in this faceless dispute resolution mechanism scheme. The next change is with respect to affordable housing projects, which has been extended by 1 year to 31st March 2022. And it has also been extended to notify rental housing projects. This is a very welcome move for real estate developers who are engaged in affordable housing projects where they could not complete the projects and get an approval due to the pandemic last year. giving more relief to the tax, to small taxpayers. The monetary threshold for tax audit has now been increased and doubled from the existing 5 crore to 10 crore limit. Obviously, it comes with certain conditions which are there in terms of the 95% of transaction being in digital mode in terms of the purchase and sales transactions. So all those conditions are there to enable a person qualify for not being applicable for a tax audit for small SSEs. At the same time, there is a welcome relief in terms of non-payment of interest under 234C of the Act for deferment of advance tax, where dividend income is earned by a taxpayer, because this income is something which cannot be anticipated by a shareholder, because the dividend declared by the company, the final dividend normally, if not interim, the final dividend generally comes post the AGM, and the shareholder may not have a position to properly preempt the amount of dividend it would be receiving. So any shortfall in the advance tax and the defer and the interest which comes on deferment of such advance tax would not apply, and it would now be treated as par, as if, you know, the capital gains income is used to, in terms of whenever you earn the dividend, only at that point of time the trigger for payment of advance tax for such dividend would be there. Obviously, this change would not apply to deemed dividends, which triggers whenever there is a loan or advance which is given by closely held companies to the shareholders or concerns in which they have substantial interest. One very more welcome change in terms of increasing the safe harbor limit for home buyers and real estate developers. The existing safe harbor of 10%, where the transaction value and the stamp duty value, the difference was 10%, has now been increased to 20%. Meaning thereby, if the stamp duty value is more than 20% of the transaction value, there would still be no deemed gift tax in the hands of the buyer residence holder. At the same time, there would be no taxation in the hands of the real estate developer under Section 43 CA of the Income Tax Act. However, this has been given for a only limited period of time to boost the real estate sector and to allow the developers to clear their inventory. This safe harbor is increased only to 30th June 2021. And post 30th June 2021, the limit will again fall back to 10%. One point to note is that this is applicable only in cases where there is a primary sale. It is not applicable for cases where there is a second-hand purchase. So it has to be a property which has to be bought by the real estate developer. At the same time, the government has clarified that presumptive taxations for professionals, where only 50% of revenues and gross receipts were taxable, where the receipts did not exceed 50 lakhs, would not be applicable to LLPs, which are governed by the LLP Act of 2008. However, this presumptive taxation for professionals continue in the hands of the partnership firm. So this is one area where there is not a level playing field for the partnership firm and the LLPs, where the partnership firm get a benefit of presumptive taxation for running a profession, but not the LLPs. There is one welcome change which has come for with respect to retirement benefit accounts, which are opened by individuals when they travel to outside India and have employment of a sizable years there, and they are supposed to open a retirement benefit account in the host country. What happens is that the income is taxable in such cases in the foreign country on a receipt basis when actually the money is received on retirement. However, generally India would tax it such retirement benefits annually on an accrual basis, because once an individual returns back to India, his global income is subject to tax, whether it is received or not. So there was clearly a mismatch in terms of taxability. So this is a very welcome change which the government has brought. Obviously, this has some conditions that, you know, the country should be a notified country, and the conditions with respect to the retirement fund being taxable only on receipt basis in the country in which the individual has traveled. Once all those conditions are satisfied, such income would not be taxable in the hands of the individual in India. So these are the changes largely from the direct tax side. Altogether, if we see, a lot of things have been relaxed. There are certain good news for the small taxpayers. Obviously, there is no new tax in the hands of the super rich, but obviously there are some instances and backdoor taxes in terms of tweaking with the ULIP related changes, PF related changes, and obviously the restructuring and the corporate M&As, the M&A related transactions where the big changes with respect to taxing the partners and the partnership form on retirements and the biggest one in terms of goodwill, all those will surely keep the consultants and the industry houses busy in terms of making representations adequately before the finance minister. With this, I would like to conclude this small session on the direct tax. I'll over to Aditya. I'll just hand over this to Ranjit to take over the indirect tax related changes. Ranjit, over to you.
Thank you, Basant and Aditya. So firstly, welcome to all our listeners, participants. I will cover the indirect tax related proposals, which are in two baskets, basically those concerning GST and those concerning customs law. The first set of points I would pick up on are the GST related amendments that have been proposed. Some of them are in the realm of just making clarity to the law, and some of them are far reaching and have quite a consequence that we will see as we go along. So taking up the first of those points is the scope and ambit of the concept of supply, which has been expanded in a way such that it clarifies now that when a club or an association is transacting with the members or its constituents, there is going to be a liability to GST. The reason for this amendment is that the Supreme Court in 2019 had rendered judgments in the context of service tax law and sales tax law, VAT law, wherein it was held that there would not be an application of tax in those situations concerning those legislations. This is the Calcutta Club decision and the Ranchi Club decision of the Supreme Court. Now, there was a doubt which arose whether the GST law also has a immunity from taxation effectively, or then there is going to be a levy. With this amendment, that sort of doubt is put to rest. There is also a consequential amendment which has been made in one of the schedules to the CGST Act. And with this, I think it paves the way for the levy of GST on transactions between a club and association and its members or constituents. So that's the first of the legal amendments that we are going to sort of talk about. The next amendment is a far more significant one. And as you would see on your screen now, is concerning the input tax credit. There was a set of conditions that one as a recipient, a taxpayer, registered recipient would need to have adhered to in order to take and enjoy input tax credit. These were spelled out in Section 16, and then there were certain other restrictions and guidelines and limitations that were placed. Now, four of those conditions existed in Section 16 since inception of GST law. There is now today a fifth condition which is added. Effectively, clause AA is added into Section 16(2), which is to say that the invoice of which you wish to take credit is available in terms of the supplier having filed his return and is available in your, as the person who wants to take the credit, the recipient, in your 2A register. Now, what does this effectively mean? This effectively means that not only will you need to receive the goods, the services, have the invoice in your hand, make a payment for that invoice that is there, invoice and the tax in there, file your own return, you will now also have to ensure, or before you take credit, at least before that, you have to ensure that your supplier has made an adequate return and therefore that is uploaded and that outward supply has been recorded and reflected by him in his return. And thereafter, it in a way reflects in your, as the person who wants to take the credit, to a register. Now, that condition not having been met, effectively availability of credit itself comes into question. So till now, we were grappling with Section 43A, which was introduced in the statute book, but not notified, which prescribed manner of filing returns and certain other aspects of matching and things like that. And then there was a Rule 36.4, which has also been challenged in various high courts. And in a manner of speaking is granting concession by saying that you get 5% of the unmatched credit as being a further facilitation of additional credit that you may draw, even if it did not reflect in your 2A. With this provision, which is Section 16(2)(AA) amendment, which is proposed, what will effectively happen is that the concession in 36.4 needs to be sort of tested out, whether it's going to be inconsistent with this provision. The necessity of 43A, which was a provision which has been hanging and has not yet been notified, what is its life and what is its effect, whether that is even necessary any longer, is something that we will have to wait and watch. But from a trade and industry point of view, this is a big one. This means that as we go about taking our credits, we will have to ensure that it's reflected in our 2A. The supplier is also acting in a compliant fashion. And if not, then other measures will have to be taken, else we bring into jeopardy our input tax credit. So I would just repeat the fact that this is an important one. This is a big one. And it will cause a bit of a flutter in the manner in which it sort of settles down. This particular amendment also had a little bit of a history in the sense that there have notices already which have been flying around from the department, which require that the tax be paid in the case that it's not reflected in the 2A. Now, there is possibly three timelines that we can look at. That which concerns the period before the introduction of Rule 36, that which comes the period which is from the time that Rule 36 came in until the amendment in 16(2)(AA), and then thereafter. So in the three timelines, the notices, if any, which are issued, how should they be dealt with? For a practice of taking credit, what should be the system and methodology from the time this amendment comes into force? What should be the practice? So these are all things which will now have to be considered carefully and sort of system evolved for this purpose. The next amendment, in a way of speaking, is going to affect the professional fraternity, because what has been proposed is in a compliance related issue, is that the requirement of a professional to prepare a reconciliation statement and certify that, which is to be filed along with the annual audit return, is no longer needed. Now, when I say no longer needed, it's a little unclear at this moment whether this is meant for the financial year of 2021 or even earlier. It appears it should apply to the year of financial year of 2021, and meaning that from financial 2021, you won't need to file a reconciliation statement certified by a chartered accountant. The company taxpayer or the SSE taxpayer himself or herself will have to make that reconciliation with the annual audited accounts and certify that and put it up into the portal in the electronic manner in which it is prescribed. So in a nutshell, what this amendment does is takes away the responsibility which was previously cast on a professional, which is external to the taxpayer, and now brings that onus and responsibility upon the taxpayer itself, and therefore sort of places a greater responsibility on the shoulders of the taxpayer. Taking up the sort of next slide, the Section 50 amendment essentially is to clarify a position in law where interest is liable to be paid only on the net amount of tax that is due in cash. So after adjustment or reduction of the credit available in the electronic credit ledger. This was, of course, a matter of great amount of litigation. Various high courts had to intervene. And then the GST Council had also made a recommendation way back in 2018. Unfortunately, it was not given the due effect. Now with this amendment, it's brought into the statute book. The next amendment that we have to talk about and focus on is the requirement that your GSTR 1 and 3B will have to match, And in case of a failure, or rather, I would say in case of a mismatch in that situation, that we have a mismatch, there is a recovery power and provision which is now brought into force or will be brought into force. So GSTR 1 deals with concerns, your outward supply, and GSTR 3B is effectively that summary return which concerns making the payment of GST on the periodic basis. Now, if there is a mismatch, in a way of speaking, it's a self-acknowledgement that there is a shortfall in the self-assessed tax that you have paid. So the department now will have the ability to sort of make a recovery of that. Now, it seems that such a recovery will be without much of a proceeding to be gone through, because the amendment has been made in Section 75, which deals with determination of tax. And it's in a notwithstanding, it's couched in notwithstanding clause. And the notwithstanding is with respect to provisions which deal with proceedings for demand to be raised and to then, you know, sort of progress to recover that, Section 73 and 74. So I would issue a notice, I would then call for a hearing, and then I would go into a adjudication and recover that amount. Now, notwithstanding those provisions in Section 73 and 74, in terms of Section 75, there is an amendment now which says that a recovery can be made. And the manner of recovery will be as is prescribed in another section, which is 79. In a nutshell, what it conveys is that the self-assessed amount of tax, which you ought to have paid yourself, which you recognized and acknowledged, and if it's unpaid, the recovery will sort of occur in quick time. I think this is an important one where we may have some challenges, because sometimes there are mathematical sort of inconsistencies, or there are reconciliation issues which come up, and they come up at the time of, you know, filing the 3B. And at that event, how do you sort of, you know, deal with it, and what do you do is something that the trade and industry will have to be, you know, careful and navigate when it, as and when it sort of encounters that. Another amendment which is there in terms of empowering the authorities is for provisional attachment in certain situations where there is a situation of inspection, search and seizure, etc. This is, of course, to protect the interest of the revenue. And previously, it was a limited circumstances in which it was available. Now, this is sought to be sort of broad-based. Obviously, the drive of the revenue department is to ensure that there is no leakage. And this is yet one more tool in their hand for the purposes of such protection of revenue. Can we take the next slide, please? There are certain changes proposed to the Integrated Goods and Services Tax Act, which is the provisions dealing with cross-border trade. So the first of those is that the ability to pay tax and make an export is now no longer available, which means that all situations will be of payment, non-payment of tax in cash, and you would pay it effectively in terms of an export without payment of tax, under a copy of under a cover of an LUT, a letter of undertaking. Certain exceptions will be pronounced in the context of types of parties or in terms of the class of goods or services where it may be permissible to pay the GST, IGST, and then claim a refund. But the rule will now be that you will not have to pay IGST and therefore claim refund. You will simply make an export without having to make such a payment. So that's one of the first amendments that are there. And it will, you know, of course, necessitate everyone taking a careful, you know, step in that direction that you are aligned with this provision and requirement. The second amendment is concerning SEZs. And here the supply, whether it is to a developer or to a unit, will be zero rated only if it is for authorized operations, which means that you need to turn around to your SEZ developer unit to whom you're making a supply and ensure that the supply that you make is covered by the list of authorized operations that they have and they have requested for. If not, then there comes up the need for you to apply the tax, because it would not enjoy the status of a zero rated supply. The third of the conditions is that where there has been an export situation of goods and there has been a refund which has been claimed and the money is enjoyed by the exporter, but there has not been a collection of the foreign exchange, there was actually no provision in the GST law for such a situation. Now what they have done is make an amendment to propose an amendment to say that in the event you have received such a refund and you are unable to collect the monies as is prescribed in FEMA, you will have to come back and make that amount pay it back to the revenue department, because you cannot enjoy a amount of refund when you have not been able to realize the export proceeds. So it will in fact become far more cumbersome and maybe even make it even more necessary that an exporter take all steps and measures to ensure realization of the foreign exchange for an export situation. You may have the next slide, please. Certain provisions which are concerning the detention, seizure, release and confiscation of goods and conveyances, there is a set of changes which have been made. So first is that there is a delinking of the provisions concerning confiscation from detention, seizure, release. And there is also a sort of separation of the provisions which concern payment of tax and that concerning detention, seizure, release and confiscation of goods and conveyances. Since the inception of GST, there have been quite a few matters which have gone to the High Court concerning conveyances and vehicles which were detained, seized, and then sought to be confiscated and whatnot. And several courts have had to, you know, sort of step in and clarify when detention was permissible, whether it was authorized, it was illegal or not, and then whether there is a confiscation in that situation which was permissible. Including in January of 2021, where the Kerala High Court had to lay down guidelines. So all of these provisions will sort of effectively make it clearer of how that process should operate. It also sort of, these provisions also raise a certain amount of greater penalty. So they raise the limit and therefore there'll be a greater penalty which will be in the prescribed situations. Can we take the next slide, please? Coming to the last topic on the indirect tax space is the customs related amendments. Broadly, you could say that they're in two sort of buckets, to say, so to speak, those concerning rate and those concerning trade facilitation measures. Now, those concerning rate are driven primarily to enable, to support and to give a boost to the domestic manufacturing. And in that context, there have been certain basic custom duty for certain parts and components and imports that would have to be made to hike the customs duty rate on those goods that are needed. These include for the renewable energy sector, for the auto sector, and in a way, therefore, give a boost to the Atmanirbhar Bharat project. The connected sort of rate change is where there has been an imposition of a new cess in name of the agricultural infrastructure and development cess. The stated objective is, of course, known to everyone now. But what it has done is that it will be levied side by side with basic customs duty. It will be on the same value as the assessable value of the goods. And in effect, there will not be, in most cases, a impact on the consumer, including in the context of products which are diesel and petrol, because what they have done is they have tinkered with the basic customs duty and reduced that. So the point of greater impact of duties will not be felt, but there is a new cess that you will have to deal with. You will have to declare that in the bill of entries that you file, and that's how it's going to be from here on. Another amendment which is there and in a way concerns the rate is that henceforth, and this is a novel sort of amendment which has been proposed, is henceforth conditional exemption notifications will have a limited lifespan. And it seems that government and revenue found situations where they were left with a situation where old exemption notifications were continuing, languishing, and they were not aware, and somewhere therefore it needed to be revamped. And therefore, going forward, it seems that they have set themselves this target of giving you an exemption notification for a limited duration. The other of the amendments that we are concerned with, and this is a welcome amendment, is that there has been a timeline prescribed. This is amongst, I would call, within the trade facilitation measures. Is there's a timeline prescribed for a agency to now issue the show cause notice, which agency has either begun an audit or a search and has or has issued summons to you in an inquiry mode. Previously, there were situations where these agencies would, you know, sort of initiate inquiry or conduct their search, etc., but not complete the investigation or inquiry, having collected some amounts of duties which they believe to be payable. And in that way, the matter would continue to languish and the SSC would not have closure on that issue. This is a welcome move from that perspective. Can we take the last slide? Certain other finer aspects on the trade facilitation measures, one of the first one being a bill of entry to be filed one day prior to the arrival of the goods. This is effectively to move towards digitalization, to reduce dwell time, and to maybe smoothen the processes at the customs houses and enable importers to move quickly along and have the goods cleared. In that connection, there will also be a common customs electronic portal. It seems that the GSTN success has sort of rubbed off, and this common customs electronic portal will possibly be available to the importer-exporter community and not just to the CHAs, which was the case with the ICEGATE. So we are moving towards a greater amount of digitalization, and the customs electronic portal seems to be a step in that direction. The last point I would talk about is that in India's commitment or having been a signatory to the HSN 2022, we will have a sort of revamping of our tariff code and the tariff lines so that it is aligned with the international sort of position and tariff that is the HSN, which will go into effect from the 1st of January 2022. That's a process which will happen sometime in the later part of this year, but a number of exemptions will get revisited, tariff lines will get upgraded, and there are new items which may have to be accommodated in the tariff code so that they keep up with the times and the technology that is been going ahead fast as it is. So with these points on the customs law, I would close out on the indirect tax proposals that have been there in the budget yesterday. Aditya?
Yeah.
Back to you.
Mr. Chattopadhyay, we have, I think so we have ended our session and
we actually we are running late, so let us skip the question answer session. Mm-hmm. And dear all, with this we come to the end of this session, a very enriching session on the budget 21-22. Here I take the opportunity to thank Mr. Vikash Agarwal, President ICC, Mr. Pallav Gupta, Chairman of the Expert Committee on Taxation ICC and Advisor Taxation ITC, Mr. Shantanu Gupta, Professor of Economics, XLRI, Jamshedpur, Dr. Shahbat Azim, Founder CEO, Global Healthcare, and Mr. Aditya Hans, Mr. Ranjit Mahatani, both partner of Duho Advisors LLP, and Mr. Bhashan Gandhian, principal Duho Advisors, for their very factual commentary on the budget and its possible impact in the year 21-22. I hope that you have all enjoyed the program and will carry some value addition in the matter of common man's understanding of the budget implications. Once again, I thank you all for attending the program and wish you a patronage in our next occasions also. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.